Welcoming from Seattle, West Coast, we've got Jen Akin from Rumba. We've got from East Coast, New York, we've got Chockie Tom of Doom Tiki, Austin Hartman of Paradise Lounge, and from the West Coast of London. We have Gergö Muráth from Trailer Happiness. Welcome to the ultimate East Coast, West Coast Throwdown. Welcome, everyone. How are you doing?
Hi.
Hey. Actually, I have something very funny to point out. This is the tiki shirt Sergio got married in.
Which is... It's just precisely the same that Dawn is wearing.
No way!
You guys have great taste.
Oh my god, that's hysterical.
I tell you what, yeah. Dawn has... Dawn hasn't seen this yet, but hold on, where is it? Here. I have to share this live on air. This is...
Oh my god, that's awesome!
It's an original for anyone who can see at home. It's an original... Chockie creation. It's Dawn in the middle of a bottle of champagne.
I love it, Chockie. You are a legend. That is the best present I could have ever gotten. That is just awesome. Thank you, girl. I love you.
For anyone who doesn't know, Chockie makes the best pictures in the world, and I was introduced to them through Sergio's Facebook, which is continually full of memes and, you know, and Chockie, basically. And we woke up this morning. We set the alarm. We were getting up at I was getting up at 6. I don't know what time Dawn got up at 6. And the first thing I saw was this picture that Chockie had done. And I was just like, it's going to be okay. It was like a good omen for the day.
And I can't believe I've only just seen it. I mean, that shows you kind of how crazy the day's been. I haven't even looked at a message or a phone. And I keep seeing these things.
So I'd love just quickly to throw the mic to each of you. I'd love you to just quickly introduce yourself, where you're from, what you're doing. Introduce yourself to the world, to the people who might not know you. So Jen, hello.
Hi, I'm Jen. I live here in Seattle. I'm actually from the Kansas City area. I moved into Seattle in 2012, and I actually walked into Rumba like a year after it opened in 2013. I saw Kate Perry behind the bar, and I was like, this is the bar I want to work at forever. and I actually walked in not liking rum, and then Kate Perry happened to me. So
Kate Perry's happened to a lot of us, girl, and we're all over.
I kind of stalked her into being my best friend. And then in 2016, they hired me, and within 6 months I was managing. I've been the GM for 3 years and there for 4. So that's what I do.
Amazing. Amazing. And it's really funny. The thing I've loved about the last couple of weeks is I feel like I know you guys so well and I've never met you.
I know. I haven't met any people on here, but I feel like you're all my best friends. So.
That's kind of the beauty of rum, right? That's kind of like we would be doing this in a bar if we were all able to travel and be together in person as we wanted to be. So we're hopefully doing the next best thing and just setting up those next meetings whenever they happen and wherever they happen. So
absolutely.
So thank you so much for joining us, Jen. And we've also got Austin. Austin, hey, how are you doing?
I'm going. Very good. You?
Yes, very good.
Wait, we're live. Yeah, that's as good as it's gonna get.
My name is Austin Hartman. I live in New York. Co-founder of Doom Tiki with Chockie. We've been running that for the past year plus now, and until recently, sadly, my bar Paradise Lounge, after 2 years, closed down after failed negotiations with our landlord. So, but
super sad.
The spirit is we'll remain. We're going to do pop-ups and fun things around the city and hopefully other cities when we can travel.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. We
And we wish you luck because we know how hard it is out there. We know the strong survive. So I think it's only going to be more exciting things happening for you.
Exactly. And we're going to still look at spaces and things like that. Will it be in New York? Who knows? Will it be in maybe Puerto Rico or another city?
You'll be in London at some point.
I will.
Yes.
If you go to Puerto Rico, can Mitch and I visit?
That'll be the next anniversary.
Yeah.
The 51st anniversary. Puerto Rico, let's do it.
Fired
up. Navy welcome.
Well, welcome, Austin. And I actually read your name that you had up there. I read that as Mrs. Sergio. I thought Chockie had competition for a second. I was like, shit, okay, all right. We're really throwing down tonight. Chockie, welcome. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Baby
so
Yoda.
Good. It's it. Chockie, you are, as Dawn expressed, like, you are one of these people who I feel I know just through so much content online. And now it's wonderful to finally meet you in person. So,
well, I'm not in person. I'm Chockie Tom. I'm originally from Los Angeles. I'm currently in Brooklyn, but moving to London to join my husband, Sergio.
Yay!
And I'm the New York brand ambassador for Ming River Baijiu, and I am one of the co-founders of Doom Tiki. And I do a lot of advocacy work for the indigenous community in regards to the hospitality industry.
Amazing.
Amazing. And yeah, we've really been enjoying all of your talks online and following those very closely. Can you just very quickly, if you could sum up, if it's possible, to sum up Doom Tiki and the concept of it for people who might not be familiar with it?
Okay. So basically, Doom Tiki is a variation on Tiki that takes away all the problematic elements. We don't use icons. We don't use sexually exploited or exploitative imagery of brown women, and we create an escapist or kind of like drinking situation with theater and fun and all stuff that's like doom metal and like satanic themed, especially since we figure everyone has been disrespecting everybody else's religious iconography. So why not go really fun? Why not go really far with it and have fun with it and be kind of cheeky about it? And then on top of that, we like to fundraise for a lot of communities, indigenous and Pacifica, and whatnot, that are still dealing with the environmental impacts and the social and and health impacts of dealing with being colonized. And then on top of that, we're currently working in a program where we have bartenders from different cultures creating, you know, a culturally appreciative experience from their perspective to kind of share, like to reclaim Tiki and use it as a tool to educate about respecting other cultures.
Amazing. And it's such a big topic right now. And I think you've really been at the forefront of bringing that to
most people. She's not a robot. That's just her Wi-Fi.
Oh, East Coast versus West Coast.
Here we go. It's starting already.
It's going to be punchy.
We're gonna dive into this more as part of this session. But there's someone noisy in the background that we still need to introduce. So, Sergio, can we see you as well?
Hey, Mr.
Hello, Chuck. Welcome back.
Hello. You might see I changed both my hat and my tiki shirt.
We appreciate the
previous session. This is a very non-political one. I got this from Chockie, actually, like most of my very good tiki shirts, including the one that Dawn appears to be wearing. But yeah, hi. I'm Sergio. I work at Trailer Happiness. It's not easy to pin down what I do. I'm the rum brain. I'm the rum brain at Trailer Happiness. Mainly, I think that's my position, and I put out fires when it needs to be. And I also work as the what's the official title? I am the trade development manager for the UK for the Verdi Park Estate, which sounds amazing. Up until very recently, I was also the entire team. So, you know, the management was a... I managed a large team of myself. you know, pretty
that must have been a lot of work.
it's impossible. I was constantly late for my meetings with myself. you know, right after putting me on a session following my bosses, now you're pitting me against my wife. I think you guys have something here.
We just want to test you, Sergio. We just want to see if you.
Is that why? Is that why this is at 4:30 in the morning?
we thought if we were staying up, you should stay up.
And I was there for the 10 a.m. opener as well.
It's a case of all for one and one for all.
we're just including you. We're including all of you in our social bubble.
Social bubble.
I don't think you can see our social bubble, but yes, welcome to our social bubble.
where you're sitting right now is the only place I have ever seen the single greatest rum I have ever tried. I've only ever seen it twice. One of them when I did a tasting for 67 Pall Mall, which is a rich kids club down in St. James. And they said, yeah, we'd like you to do a tasting of 10 rums. And they gave me a budget of $8,000 to get those 10 rums.
Yeah. These one are of people the ones that drink like some of the top wines in the world as if they were going out of fashion. So.
One of the rums I got was a 25-year-old Veronelli Barbancourt. And the only other time I have ever seen that is in Sekinda's secret room of awesomeness. There's two bottles there, which is mental. I remember where you're sitting.
Bring it in the morning, Sekinda.
Just so everyone knows, we are alone in the building. I have a pass that works.
I'm in Kilburn. That's NW. So. I'll get an Uber after this.
I can't wait to get the phone call after that happens.
we apologize in advance, Chucky.
Do you?
Go on, Sergio.
Sorry, nothing.
No. Chucky, he's much more well-behaved in this session.
That's not true. He's not wearing pants.
She means the U.S. meaning of pants.
Yes.
That's okay. I understand.
So the premise of this session is we're going to have a rum bar throwdown. So it's East versus West. West being West Coast.
I thought it was rum bar. I thought it was the rum bar throwdown.
It is the rum bar throwdown. Yeah, little product placement in there for you. A choice of words worked out well for you.
I got your favorite.
Oh, yeah?
Damn it.
That's cool. Hey, look.
Oops. Damn it.
Okay, we got to move the lovebirds on. We're never going to get here.
Get a room. We're going to take on three contentious topics in the rum industry. Each side is going to have 2.5 minutes to debate on them. We're going to pitch between one to the other, go back and forth. And then you, the viewers, are going to decide who wins. So, in the comments, I'm not sure, we definitely didn't brief this to the back of house team, so I apologize right now. But whoever's doing the black top comments, we're going to put up the title, and then you can either react love heart or laughy face. That's how we're going to vote for the winners of each of these rounds, okay? So,
where did you get the idea of voting like that, Mitch?
So there's a very, very famous industry biscuit competition, which is now a chocolate bar competition, and we were stuck for ideas, and then suddenly the chocolate bars popped up, and we went, "This is a great idea. This is how we should vote for everything in life." So if you want to vote for East Coast tonight, you vote Love Hearts. If you vote for West Coast, you're voting Laughy Face. And the first round, without further ado, Round one, Tiki is dead. So voting for Tiki is dead, we have East Coast Austin and Chockie. Voting for Long Live Tiki is the West Coast, Jen and Sergio. So we're going to start off with Austin, followed by Jen, followed by Chockie, followed by Sergio. At the end, you, the audience, get to vote. Tiki is dead, love heart, or Long Live Tiki, laughy face. Okay, it's very scientific. A lot matters. And I tell you how much matters on this. We have
a trophy.
A trophy. It's engraved. This is an engraved trophy. And you can see it here. Look at the quality, right? And this is engraved Black Top Day Rumba Throwdown Champion 2020. So the winner, wherever you are, we will get this trophy to you, whoever wins. So this is what's up for grabs.
I mean, what more do you want?
I mean,
two.
Do we have to share one and send it back and forth?
The expense.
Send it back and forth.
The second one.
We did.
Somehow it's going to end up in London.
We found this
for 6 months.
But we found this beautiful golfing trophy, but it wasn't going to be delivered until like after the event. So we're like, we'll just get one for now and figure it out later. I hope they don't notice. Thanks, Jen.
Maybe not the last experience.
So we've got our bell. We're going to start off. So Tiki is dead. Up first, we've got Austin Hartman, East Coast. Tiki is dead, 2.5 minutes. You're up now.
But I'm going to kind of maybe shoot myself in the foot out the gates and say Tiki isn't dead.
Yes.
Come on, Austin.
No.
I guess definitely not how the debate works, but I like it. Come on.
I think the current concept and notion of Tiki is dead. Will the spirit of Tiki die? No, not so much. I think the death is of the current discourse of how we discuss it and view it. So, you know, things like Trash Tiki, Doom Tiki, Rum Bars itself acknowledging the issues of Tiki is kind of like going to be the, I would say, next wave of how we view Tiki and discuss it. And I say next wave because I know Sergio is a big ska fan, so I'm gonna say like a third wave of Tiki revival, and then there was a second Tiki revival in which it kind of blew up a bit. And now that people understand rum and are getting more excited about the spirit category, we can take this time to develop and change and alter the discourse to not be as offensive or appropriated. How much
time? Like you've got one minute left, Austin.
All right. Cool. Tiki.
Seal the deal.
Tiki is dead.
Something changed there.
I think there's.
That's it.
I think there is definitely like a lot of problematic issues that we need to be addressed. And kind of deadening one side of like how we view it now, how it's glorified, should be that part of it should be dead or just adjusted and then go forward.
Love it. Right. So
we've got 20 seconds left. If there's any closing statements you want to make before we pass over.
Love all you guys. Thanks for tuning in. I'm having a really good time. Black Tate, 50th anniversary. East Coast is the best coast, kind of. I mean, Chockie and I are both from the West Coast, so it kind of makes sense. We're planning off the East Coast.
I love the bribery and corruption at the end. I thought that was genius.
Austin, you're literally the nicest debate team champion ever. We are moving on to Jen Akin, West Coast. Long live Tiki, 2.5 minutes, go!
Okay,
I'm going to pull an Austin and say that I kind of, at one point I wanted Tiki to be dead, and I'm going to tell you why. It's because Rumba is a rum bar that specializes in traditional rum cocktails and really highlighting rum. And I think that Tiki, rum is often pigeonholed into Tiki. However, I have kind of changed my mind. We do a Tiki night every Wednesday, or we were doing a Tiki night every Wednesday, and it brought a lot of people in. That is then a really great opportunity to educate about rum. And we are actually in the process, because we're crazy, of opening a Tiki bar right next door to Rumba. And like Austin was saying, we have decided to take an approach that takes all of the cultural appropriation out of Tiki and create a very Pacific Northwest inspired Tiki bar. So it's going to be like under the sound, lots of like emerald and green colors, lots of imagery of like the natural wildlife that lives under the water here in Seattle. And all of the drinks are going to be inspired by Seattle itself and the Pacific Northwest. And so I think that that is the direction that Tiki is going. Like Austin was saying, I think that old school Tiki and like the way that we've approached it is fading out into like this really new, I think, cooler version of Tiki, which is everyone's individualistic approach to what it means to be like an escapist bar, you know? And I think the word Tiki is actually going to be kind of like, maybe leave the lexicon or be used less. And, you know, I kind of refer to our bar as like an adventure bar. Like you're walking in, going on an adventure, and every aspect of it is adventurous. You walk in, you don't realize that you're in Seattle. You think you're underneath a shipwreck and you're drinking rum that sank into the bottom of the ocean and was discovered. And you're drinking all these really cool cocktails that are like everything you expect from Tiki, over the top garnishes, fire, smoke, all of those things, but without all of like that really offensive like imagery and things like that. So I love that part of it. It's also been really fun for me developing those cocktails and like doing a lot of research and finding things that are inspirational about where I live and flavors where I live, and kind of taking the core concept of escapism and just like the awe and the jaw dropping like imagery that you get when you walk into a Tiki bar.
Well, hey,
nice.
Hey,
very cool. Very good. Thank you, Jen. All right, we're going back to East Coast. Chockie Tom, you're up. Tiki is dead. 2.5 minutes. Go.
I mean, I don't know if you can really kill something that isn't real. It's, you know, completely made up.
Oh!
I mean, you can't take what you want from other things and make it a thing. But it might be undead, because no matter what happens with what's changing and when the world gets terrible, it keeps kind of coming back. But I've definitely sent it to hell, and I'm kind of liking where that's going. So, Satanic Tiki is awesome. Taking away the word is going to be the next big step. And then redefining what it is by the people who have been affected by it is definitely the next step. And whatever that is going to be is not going to be the traditional appropriative gatekeeping. We're old dudes that are experts on what Tiki is, and we're the most, you know, awesome about like supporting Pacifica and stuff like that. All that stuff is definitely out the window. And I think also like just what Tiki has been is going to be redefined by the like new diversity and younger bartenders that have new ideas how they want to recreate what escapism is and what it means, and not define it by being like a continuation of colonialism. How much longer do I got?
You've got 30 seconds left.
God damn it, I'm a fast talker.
I can't believe you can't.
30 seconds now.
And I'm the quiet one in our relationship. But wrong with it is definitely dying. And sometimes it's just good to let some parts of things go extinct.
Nice.
Awesome.
I like it.
And for the final round, we've got West Coast Sergio. Long live Tiki. 2.5 minutes. Go.
Yeah, I actually accidentally answered this question at the end of my previous session. Tiki is very much alive and well. And thankfully, it's shedding the cultural baggage that everybody else before me has mentioned. And that's not a bad thing. It's not the essence of Tiki. The essence of Tiki is escapism. The essence of Tiki is being transported out of a mundane, boring world. It's the end of your workday. It's going off into something else. And there's no reason why that world should be nothing more than a colonialist fantasy, because that's not what you need. But as Chockie mentioned, it comes back every time things go to hell. You know, original Tiki was born out of prohibition, and it was born out of the Great Depression. They needed a way out. Right now, everything has gone to hell. Bring its head up, but in new forms. And thankfully, those new forms seem to be better, but it's very much alive and well. You know, there are fantastic tiki drinks. You can reinterpret that. If you just take a tiki drink as a really, really complicated, wonderful, flavorful punch, there's no reason why we can't have that. There's no reason why we can't redefine it into something that's actually appreciative of a culture and that's actually leaves you with that feeling of escapism and with that feeling of being out of your boring, everyday, difficult, shitty existence. So Tiki is not that, and Tiki is never going to be that, because you need that. You need that in your life. Hopefully, it'll change. The name is probably going to change. We're probably going to be talking about tropical, or we'll be talking about escapist. But we'll be talking about something that's closely related to the core positives present in the Tiki movement.
I feel my boss is going to kill me because...
Our makeshift bell is precarious at best.
Well, you're alone in the building, so...
Yeah, but the reason that they've got to where they've got to is because they've really got attention to detail. So when they come in and there's a massive chunk at the floor, they may notice. And I feel that we might get blamed because there's video evidence.
We're gonna break down this a little bit. We're just gonna chat in a little bit more detail because we think it's such
and
an important topic.
And people get voting. Get
voting whilst you're doing it. Throw up your comments. Throw up your views, and you know, love heart or
probably
face. That's your that's your battle right now. So, let's break this down a little bit. Obviously, we sort of gave you sides to break
Bacon.
Down, but we also want to like. Hear where you're really at and hear what things are. And I think it's an interesting idea, this idea of dropping away the shit parts of Tiki and keeping the bits which we actually love. But then we also have this, you know, as Chockie mentioned, you know, the next phase is, do we change the name? Do we shed that as well? And Chockie, I guess to start with yourself, like, where would you like to see the next stage, the next era go to?
Well, I think there's a couple of important things to consider. Okay. Yeah, your son wanted to go away from you, Sergio. But I think like one of the things that we need to consider is a lot of times when we kind of get into this whole space where caricatures of people are acceptable, we forget about the people that they're based on and the people these things are taken from. So I think as we become more aware, especially with the current state of the world and things like that, if we're going to continue to create these escapist fantasies and things like that, we're going to definitely have to acknowledge the problems with people in islands that could disappear in a few generations because of like climate issues and things like that. And, you know, I think working with these communities and listening to voices from these communities is like the next important step. And then also, if you're coming up with a bar, you don't have to take things from other people's cultures. You can find things where you are and you can create different experiences in theater using the stuff that you have already. I mean, we've done it with another indigenous bartender. We've done it with an Indian bartender. We've had a Puerto Rican bartender. So the next Doom Tiki has like Scandinavian bartenders. So we're all kind of redefining what this escapist fantasy is by our terms. And I think that's what the future holds.
Fantastic.
And super interesting, actually, because I think when you look at culture, and I studied social anthropology at university, and it was really interesting now to see this whole Tiki
sort of not rejection, but redefinition, because I studied a lot about Polynesia, of course, because it's a lot of the basis for kind of some of the, and I'm sure Chockie, you know, the kind of whole Margaret Mead, Kontiki, blah, blah.
My mom can ask apologies.
Ah, nice. But it's super interesting to understand how it's being redefined. And I think escapism is actually something that's a really interesting term and maybe the most accurate, which it'll be interesting to see how you guys take that on.
Well, especially since the regular notion of escapism is brown people waiting on you in an island paradise and like sexually available women that don't have, that have looser morals than the women you're with. And I think that notion is going out the window, thankfully.
And Jen, I wanted to throw it to you as well, because, you know, I haven't had the pleasure of visiting Rumba yet, but from everything I see and look at, it's one of the world's best Rumbas, but not really in any kind of sort of tiki tropical sense. It's just a bar that's amazing at rum. Is that accurate? Is that a good description? How would you take it, and why did you take that route with Rumba?
So Rumba, yes, we have a very extensive selection of rum. I think we're at over 700 at this point bottles, and we're very, very small too. So like when you come to Rumba, you realize like that it's insane that we have that many. And when I actually first started at Rumba, I think we were at around 450 or 500. And my boss, I really hope that he's listening right now, but he gave me like an inventory amount, and I was like, yeah, sure, I got it, no worries. And then I went in for like my yearly review, and every yearly review, I'm like, yeah, can I actually get that increased, please? Because I just come here. Like, they come here because, you know, I have like regulars that walk in, they're like, all right, what's new? I've literally drank everything on your shelf. Like, what can I have that's new? Yeah. So that's definitely like what we focus on, is education and rum and things like that, and like teaching people that it's not what everyone thinks it is. But that being said, everyone walks in assuming or wanting it to be a tiki bar. We are very clearly not, if you are a true tiki enthusiast. We have lots of big windows. There's no tikis anywhere. We have like a small section of tiki inspired cocktails on the menu, and that's just simply because that's what people want from a rum bar. Like I said, I feel like rum gets pigeonholed into tiki so much. It's nice to teach people that they can have an old fashioned with rum, or have a daiquiri or whatever. But we decided that, you know, so many people come in wanting us to be a tiki bar, that we were like, let's make a tiki bar, but let's bring tiki into 2020, and let's not be culturally appropriative. Let's not exploit cultures. Let's take what we love and like what is surrounding us and all of those flavors. And the Pacific Northwest is already so dreamy and beautiful. Like, who wouldn't want to escape here? So why not just utilize all of that imagery and create, like I said, I don't really call it a tiki bar as much. I mean, people want to hear that word because that's like a buzzword right now. But, you know, I call it an adventure bar, an escapist bar. It's just, that's what it is. It's a place for you to escape Seattle and like feel like you're on this crazy adventure. So for me, tiki, like I've been on this roller coaster with tiki. I've hated it. I've really not loved it because I think a lot of tiki drinks aren't made like super great. I want to taste all the rums, and I like there's so much going on in so many of those cocktails. But when you're like breaking them down, I remember like the first time I had a last rites, which is four ingredients. It's like, that is a delicious tiki cocktail. I really enjoy that one. So why can't we like build off of that and really showcase delicious rums with all of these like fresh made local ingredients, things like that, and like bring tiki into now and be really aware of what's going on around us as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You've been given bad tiki drinks.
I've been given lots of bad tiki drinks in my life. Yes, that is true.
So Sergio, you're a walking encyclopedia on tiki drinks and tropical cocktails, and yet your views are very progressive compared to, say, the old school tiki mindset with it. So, you know, what point did that change? What's been your journey with tiki? You know, where do you stand with it now?
Well, I've always been fairly politically active and outspoken on all issues relating to social justice, but I saw some of the problems with Tiki, but not necessarily all of them, until I really started more seriously talking to Chockie about a year ago, and that's when I realized a host of other issues that weren't necessarily in the forefront of my thinking, and that led me down a path of change and realization for the better. So it's partially due to my own social and political beliefs, and partially due to her influence, that I now hold the views that I hold. And I think if I had more closely examined it before that, I would have probably realized it. But it's something that you get stuck in and overlook due to privilege. Like so many other issues, it's something that has to be unlearned because it's a privileged position that you can easily overlook and forget about under the right circumstances. I still, I have massive amounts of love for the drinks. I have a lot of love for a lot of people involved in the scene, especially a lot of bartenders involved in the scene. And I really, really hope that Tiki can change into something that is progressive and inclusive and welcoming. And I firmly hold that Tiki isn't dead, but I also recognize it carries a lot of baggage that needs to be shed before it can be a legitimately inclusive space. And it needs voices from the regions affected and from the people affected to lead this change. And the rest of us need to support it and amplify it as much as possible.
Amazing. And Austin, when we first got introduced, the first thing I did was look up Paradise Lounge, and you've got this beautiful, beautiful decor, and you've done such a wonderful job with the place. And I'm curious to know what your mindset was going into that bar. Was it tiki? Was it tropical? What were your goals, and what did you want to do with your rum haven?
Paradise, when it opened, we were strictly a rum bar. We were not a tiki bar, and we kind of focused on island classics. I had a great privilege to travel through a good amount of the Caribbean and kind of be inspired by just the nice, simple, not simple drinks, but just like not overcomplicated tiki drinks. And I appreciated those the much. So I was like, I want to do a menu that kind of focuses, like, run forward, highlights those. And then anyone would walk in. I mean, as Jen was saying, you're a rum bar. They just automatically say, like, oh, you're a tiki bar. You have rum. And you're like, oh, okay. All right. Let's have this conversation. And, not that it was upsetting to be classified as a tiki bar in some sense, but it was more of an invitation to have the conversation with customers about the difference of like rum and tiki, which was a lot of fun. And a lot of customers were very open to that conversation while they were having enjoying their first tea punch or Bajan rum punch kind of thing. So.
And it's interesting, as a couple of you mentioned, I think a lot of people, it's so synonymous for a tiki bar to be a rum bar and for the two to go hand in hand that, I think it is, it's less common, at least I found, to find a bar that's just, it's just a bar, but these are all rums, it's like, it's much, much harder to find generally.
But also, as
rum progresses, if we're going to see more and more bars that are just, we're going to be rum focused rather than whiskey focused.
This is something I've brought up a few times before when talking to Chockie, and you'll know what I mean, in that in the UK, the tiki scene and the rum scene is pretty much the same. It's bartenders and rum enthusiasts who are into tiki, whereas in the US, as I found out last June when I went to Hokilau for the first time, there is this whole other part of the subculture that has sometimes almost nothing to do with the drinks and nothing to do with the spirit. and you know, it's essentially cosplay more than anything, you know. And that was a shocking revelation for me. But yeah, rum is inherently tied to it because rum's heyday in the 30s came because of it. And because it uses so much.
Yeah.
I would say, going back to the Paradise Lounge thing, and also Rumba, of being like, we're a rum bar, not a tiki bar, and then you engage with a customer, and then you can start that conversation and say, maybe instead of tiki, and this is something that Sergio and Chuck and I have talked about, like, is the next word or theme tropical, or like, where does the discourse go from there?
Mm. And I guess that's the hard bit, isn't it? You can redefine something, but it's the term that unites it that's probably the most challenging to look at.
Was it just a rum bar, you know? Like,
tiki bars.
We don't go,
wine bars. Really
Scottish tartan bar, you know, like for the whiskey.
Well, you say that.
I will say, one of my very first experiences with, like, tiki enthusiasts was at this tiny bar I was working at in Ashland, Oregon, which is like a town of 20,000 people. And I was like, I was very young and I was managing my first bar. And I was like, you know what, how do I bring people in on a slow night, a tiki night? And my very first night doing this, I had like very basic tiki cocktails on the menu. I put like palm leaves on the tables. It was ridiculous, but it brought people in. And I remember like the first people through the door were people that go to TikiCon, that they go to all of the festivals. Everything. And they were like, what is this music you're listening to? This isn't tiki music. That's not a real tiki drink. What is this glassware that you're doing? And they just knew more than I did. And they were like, we travel around the country going to tiki cons wearing our outfits. We're very committed to this time period. We look like we're in the 50s all the time. This is not tiki. This is how you need to improve. And that's when I realized that, like, it's way more. It's way more than just being like, tiki night, wear a flower shirt and drink with passion fruit in it. You know, like, it was like this mind-boggling revelation of, it is everything. It is your decor. It's your music. It's a whole vibe that you give. So it, yeah, that was like the step in the wrong direction for me to like tiki at that point. But I've come around. I've been to some amazing tiki bars in the world. So yeah.
All right. Well, if you've been voting, let's see if we've got a result for the votes, and maybe we can throw something on the screen.
And I really just lost track.
I don't know if we can see the reaction, but maybe we can throw it up on the screen. Is Tiki dead?
Calculating results. I love it. That's Chanel. I can feel it.
Is Tiki dead or long live Tiki? What are we saying?
Beep, beep, beep. There's no result. Tie. It's a tie.
Might be aspects of different angles of that.
East Coast win. What?
East Coast wins.
That's okay. You still won, Sergio.
Is it because East Coast wins because Austin was basically on our team? Or
it's the longest running drinking trend. I can't imagine it's gonna end now. Who knows?
Yep.
It's undead.
90 years was fun, but on Black Dot Day in 2020.
We're here first.
We've killed off one round tradition. We're going to do another. Let's go. What else we got?
We've had so many firsts today.
Okay, right. So we're ready for round two. Luckily, round two is not contentious at all.
No.
Round two is sugar in rum. So,
we're boring.
For West Coast, arguing for sugar in rum. Don't do it. We've got Sergio and arguing for West Coast.
Come on, Sergio, I'm counting on you.
He has a secret bubble.
Tell us all about it.
Sergio, you got this.
I
can't believe you've done this.
Yes, you can.
Okay, well,
this is rude.
So we're gonna start with Sergio, then Chockie over on the East Coast, back to West Coast with Jen, and East Coast with Austin. 2.5 minutes starting now.
I mean, we mean sugar cane and rum, yeah? unless we do, I'm in a very, very difficult position. No, but a little more seriously, about 6.5 years ago, not long after I started bartending, I had a regular who came in and he gave me two bottles of rum. One of them was Angostura 1919, the other was Eldorado 12. And they were both things I've never tried, and they just completely blew my mind. They were way, way, way better quality than anything I've ever tasted before. And these days, they're not necessarily rums I seek out. They're rums I sometimes recommend, but they're not something I seek out on my own. However, if I had been given the kind of rum I drink nowadays, you know, something in the 1500 Esther range from Long Pond or Hampden. besides my tongue falling off, I may have turned my back entirely on the rum category, or gone back to Kraken or something. Now there's a lot of ways you can introduce someone to quality rum, but I think as long as you're not using sugar directly to cover up a bad distillate, which unfortunately happens, as long as you're not using sugar directly to cover up a bad distillate, but because it is a specific profile you're going for, it might have a place. Just make sure that you're transparent about it. You know, if you're gonna put stuff in your rum because you think that's how that rum works best, tell people about it so they know, so they can form an opinion. I mean, I've told countless people that a particularly well-known and beloved rum that I usually just refer to as chocolate milk has a very, very high amount of sugar in it. And they said, okay. You know, like, people who are into a specific flavor profile won't necessarily care, but they need to know. You need to be transparent and open about it. And you know, if you decide that you want to put sugar. Go ahead. I'm sure there are rums that can benefit from it. I've had rums that were delicious, and they were without the sugar. It happens. It's not the end of the world. It's actually the end of the world.
I can't wait for the discussion after this. Amazing. Let's go over to Chockie on the East Coast for sweet enough, no sugar in rum.
I really think that if you're going to be transparent, you should also not want to alter things as much as possible. If you know what you're doing, you shouldn't need to do that. And, you know, I think by adding certain things like a ton of sugar, you're masking a subpar product a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. And you're really cutting out on an opportunity for like people to experience like all the great things that drew me to like rum and things like that. I mean, I also have like a very extreme palate, and you know, I'm like a very like earthy mezcal. I sell baijiu for a living. I like funk. I like weird. So I think when those things come through, that's important. And I think if you're with the right bartender or the right people, you know, teaching people to appreciate all the nuances and other things with like rums that don't have sugar is pretty important when people discover things, as long as you're like very open about it. And, you know, it's still going to happen. People are still going to drink it. I just choose not to. And those aren't products that I would ever use for any of my pop-ups.
Bam. All right. Okay, back over to West Coast. Jen, sugar and rum, go.
I love this argument. Thank you so much for doing this. For me, I have to think about my own personal rum journey to really address this. And I'm coming from a place of people walk into my door not even knowing that we're a rum bar, and they'll order Tito's and soda and Jack Daniels and all kinds of stuff. And we don't have any of that. So for me, it goes back to educating the guest and bringing them into the world of rum. gently. So, you know, I get somebody that comes in and they're like, I love Jack Daniels. What should I drink? I'm not going to give them some sort of like super high ester, high proof rum that's going to immediately turn them off. And I remember, you know, when I first sat down at Rumba, I drank quite a bit of rum with sugar added because it was just an introduction. It was present. This was, you know, 5-6 years ago. So the sugar debate wasn't as heated as it is now. And it kind of helped me fall in love with the spirit. And now I don't drink rum with sugar added to it. I've gone on my journey. I've educated myself. I understand why people are against adding sugar. And I'm very much with Sergio, where I think that you just need to be transparent. There are brands that are never not going to add sugar. They've made tons of money on the rums that they have adding sugar. And there's a reason for that, because people really love it. And this, you know, a lot of the argument is like, well, if you're adding sugar to rum, can't you just do that at home? It's just like, make yourself an old fashioned, add the sugar at home. Well, there's a lot of people that take these rums home and they drink them neat or on the rocks because they like that there's sugar in them. And I think that with transparency, if it's in a country that allows adding sugar to rum, I think that that's fine. And like I said, for me, it's like, I just want to bring people on board. If people are drinking the brand that we're all talking about right now over something like Malibu or Captain Morgan, I feel like I've succeeded because I can easily take them from that brand into Rum McCoy, into Rum Bar, into Appleton. You know, I can take them into like these rums that are really going to like, you know, without sugar so that they can taste what the rum is like. It's more of like a jumping off point. Whereas if somebody comes in and says, I love.
I'm writing the rules. Stop. Really, really interesting and brilliant points. Really, really good, Jen.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. And last one we have East Coast Austin. Go.
Yeah, I think across the board.
Austin, please, got cats.
Sorry. I brought my cat. Jeez. transparency is the biggest thing for me. Also through my journey in rum, I think it changes on like cultural and like location. So yes, will some locations like Guyana add sugar to their rum because that's culturally how they've done it for a very long time? Go for it. And it's very good rum too, like the El Dorado 12. Delicious. But the transparency of it is, I think, the most important part, because if a consumer is having rum that they don't know has X amount of sugars added to it, and it's being, you know, like pitched as a premium rum versus what is an actual very nice rum that's very well aged with no sugar added to it, and at the same price, it doesn't really make sense to me. So I think there's some like trickery in marketing when it comes to added sugar, which is not really necessary. And also, don't be liars. I mean, you can take a look at certain islands that have distilleries on it, and one lies about sugar additive and one doesn't, and they're very honest about it. I won't name that island or the brands, but there's a very huge difference in those products, and that it shows.
And all right.
Yeah.
Oh. Still good.
No.
You have a few seconds left if you have a closing statement.
Who's the cat?
Oh. Here's
a cat. There was a question. East Coast. Oh, no. East Coast is heart. West Coast is smiley face. East Coast heart. West Coast smiley face.
So if you're voting for...
vote now.
If you're voting for...
I'd like to say, guys, I took a look at Facebook, and... there's more West Coast reacts on Tiki is dead. So I don't know who got to the previous result, but like West Coast won that one.
Sergi, wait,
you're gonna be right on the couch, honey.
Oh
And with regards to the current discussion, what I'd like to say for our actual position is the best argument we could come up for sugar, the two best arguments we could come up for putting sugar into rum is A, we used to drink that 6 years ago, and B, they make money off of it. Like,
yeah,
that's it. I think our actual position was revealed very clearly in both cases.
I think my favorite admission of the day today was when Daniele Biondi stated, yes, but I used to drink Pampero with pizza all the time.
I was like, what the fuck? We all have to start somewhere. Yeah. Like, we all
absolutely
do.
Absolutely.
And until people realize that Captain Morgan and Malibu are not rum,
we gotta
get them on that journey. And like introducing them to some really expensive, like high-end, high-proof, extra-aged rum is not going to get them on that journey, honestly.
No,
like,
absolutely not. But
I'm a Jen.
Yeah, no, me too, but you can give them very well-made, honest, no additive rums that are extremely approachable and extremely well-made and very affordable. You look at stuff like pretty much everything coming out of Foursquare, except for the exceptional cast, you know, Dolly's or Royal McCoy, very good prices. You look at everything coming out of Martinique.
I'm not denying you in any way, shape, or form. But, you know, like coming from, I have people that come in and they go, I love Zaya. It's my favorite rum. What should I drink? I can't be like, they want sugar in their rum.
Yeah.
And I have to start that conversation with them and then move them into slowly and gradually. Listen, I agree. Like I said, I don't drink rum with sugar in it. Dorley's is one of my go to, like immediately. Oh, I'm a bourbon drinker. Dorley's 12-year, easy peasy. Everyone loves it, you know? But there are certain people that are like, you know, I love the Diplomatico Reserva Exclusiva. It's my favorite rum.
Yeah.
I can't give them Foursquare 2005 and be like,
yeah, of course.
You know, like it's a gradual journey for some people.
Absolutely.
And on top of that, it's like, I wish I didn't have to stock certain rums, but I do because it's a fair amount of my regulars. That's all they drink, you know?
There is one specific rum I never stock in any bar I work in, and it's a very, very well known one that ticks all the boxes in the shit rum bingo, from fake A statement to big international company killing a small local producer to lots of additives.
That's the one I was talking about earlier, baby.
Oh yeah.
Oh, you guys love each other so much. We'll have to have a bromance, Jen. I mean, like a bromance, but prettier and more supportive.
Okay, let's move on to the most important question of the day, though.
Where is it?
Yeah, we have one more debate to get to, and but you know, I think all the points there are fascinating. All they're interesting. It is a hot topic, and I think you know What's interesting is you it really stirs people up so much, but there's so much going on with the rum world. It's so nuanced. There's so many things other than just, you know, what you drink, what your preference is really up to you, and it is your journey. And I think, you know, people do have a journey which lends them to going drier and drier as they go through their journeys. Most of them do start usually somewhere sweeter, but again, if they're in the rum camp to start with, I think Jen said it best. If you're in the rum camp already, you can always move someone up further and further. So, and the winner was East Coast for Sweet Enough.
I'd just like to reiterate that West Coast won the previous round. Somebody miscounted there, but based on the React Master.
We'll give you a time. I mean, I can see Sergio really wants the trophy.
We've got round, and it's all to play for. Let's say it's 1-1.
Awesome.
Everything to play for in the final round. The most contentious.
Sergio goes to us when we talk to him about it. He's like, just give me this round. It's my round. It's okay, my round.
So here we go. Round three, the most important debate of tonight, pina coladas versus daiquiris. Representing the daiquiris, we have East Coast, Austin and Chockie. We have West Coast representing pina coladas. We have Sergio and Jen. So we're going East Coast first, Austin, then West Coast Sergio, East Coast Chockie, West Coast Jen. Starting off with daiquiris, Austin, you're opening up. Go.
I don't even need the full 2.5 minutes. It's the best cocktail ever made in the world. No, there is it is the perfect cocktail. I mean, at Paradise, we had a very strict rule. We single strained and no garnish because it is perfect and doesn't need any of it. I personally like to do, like at home, we'll do like a little blends of various rums, but it's always go 3/4 lime, 3/4 sugar, dem 1:1, 2 ounces rum blend. And in a chilled coupe, it's perfect. You have a daiquiri timeout, which has historically been a hilarious thing. And I kind of keep to that. If you ever are feeling a little stressed or need a little break, have a daiquiri and you are leveled out. You're just good to go. I don't know. Do you want me to talk about the history of the daiquiri? Or am I defending the history or am I just saying, like, defending how delicious it is?
Austin, I think you've nailed it already. I think it's going to be a tough one to beat, but let's see. Let's see what they've got over in West Coast. So going to the West Coast of London, Sergio, 2.5 minutes on pina coladas.
Okay, a daiquiri is not a drink. A daiquiri is what you have while you try to figure out what you're going to order. You know, you go there, I'm just going to have a quick daiquiri, and you down it in 4 seconds, and you're done with it, you know. When was the last time you went, I need to sit over this and contemplate it? No. No, you have it, you doubt it. It's a 4 second drink. It's one quick pour and you're done. A colada. Now that's a drink. When was the last time two people from the same city both said, oh no, I invented the daiquiri? Well, people go like, oh, it was the sailors of the Navy. Oh yes, highly educated mixologists, obviously. you need it really, 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 really high quality to recognize this incredibly complex and difficult combination of rum, sugar, and lime. That's why everything else is built in it, because it doesn't just lend itself. Whereas the colada, you know, there's lots and lots of contention over it. Was it Ramon Monchito Perez in the Carib Hilton? Yes. Why? Because I don't remember who the other guy is. Therefore, no, but seriously, what is the one drink that everybody associates with a holiday, that everybody associates with having the time of your life, being on a beach, relaxing? It's a colada. Also, London has already made a champagne colada and a champagne daiquiri. New York, the East Coast, have they done that? Not really. In fact, when you guys come in at 1, I'll be giving you champagne coladas from our slushy machine. Because what else would you put in a slushy machine? You know, we've got daiquiri slushy. No, you don't. I mean, you know, case closed.
Amazing. And we're going back to the East Coast with Chockie for daiquiris.
I'll start this out by saying Austin Hartman does make the best pina colada I've ever had.
Whoa.
Ooh.
Thank you, Chockie.
I will say daiquiris are a great approachable cocktail. They're the best way for me to try out rums to see how I like them. And they're also the people's cocktail, Sergio. Who cares if it wasn't invented by somebody notable? It's a cocktail that anybody could make. And it's
Was it the imperialist American engineer after the war?
I will also say that Sergio does make the best daiquiri I've ever had, but now I'm considering marrying him.
You already married me. It's a little too late.
I haven't gotten the paperwork from the state yet. Anyhow, I guess it's a good approachable cocktail. It's a great way to test different rums that I like. It's cute and it comes in a lovely glass. And it's my favorite.
There is no such thing as a daiquiri glass. There is a piña colada glass.
Not in your 2 minutes, Serge. You back down there.
Yeah, Sergio tapped in half her time.
That's okay. I'll take it back and trade.
And going to the West Coast pina coladas, Jen.
I gotta say, I feel like you have like stacked the cards against me with the sugar and now this. First of all, daiquiris don't have a song. Everyone knows the pina colada song.
I was just trying to
say it. We should win based on that alone.
Okay, boomer.
I'm not gonna lie, I have a pina colada in our slushy machine at Rumba, and it is hands down our best seller. And what I love about it is it's in a slushy machine, super simple, and I can get it out very easy. We do pina colada shots and things like that. I mean, it's almost as simple as a daiquiri, but far more well-known, far more requested. It's like so tropical and delicious and refreshing. And there's so many really easy ways to just make it better than we've all had it at like vacation resorts. You know, make your own coconut cream and like fresh pressed pineapple juice, not using any of that canned stuff. It's just a delicious, tropical, tasty cocktail. That being said, this is really hard for me because daiquiri is my favorite cocktail of all time. But here, I'm not a good debater. I did not do well in debate in school.
I think you did good. Until that last moment.
Listen, we do DTOs at Rumba a lot, but now it's kind of transitioned into like these pina colada little things that we put a little flour on, and people really love that. So, you know, it's another good way to like make people happy and put a smile on people's faces. You know, they get a daiquiri, and a lot of times, as much as I love them and every bartender loves them, you know, you put a daiquiri in front of a guest at a rum bar, and kind of goes back to what we were talking about, and they don't see like all the extravagant garnishes, but you put a pina colada with like pineapple fronds and mint and we put nutmeg on top of ours and a flower, and it looks just so beautiful, and their faces light up and they're just full of joy. So I will say that the pina colada does that. It brings joy to people's faces.
Ooh, strong.
So what's the tally?
That was hard, you guys.
Yeah, we were getting it mean by this point in the session. So you're like, we need to switch it up.
Everyone's getting daiquiri tattoos, but Sergio.
On a more serious note, the daiquiri is the ideal delivery vehicle for rum. There's a reason why rum, lime, and sugar is the basis of every fucking rum drink out there that isn't stirred. You know, you can't escape it. It's wonderful.
It's a gimlet. You know, that's what it is. There's so many other cocktails with other spirits.
It's absolutely not a gimlet.
God dang it. I mean, I could have guessed.
I feel someone behind the scenes. I'm pretty sure when I was counting those little smileys and those little hugs at hearts, I was maybe counting a little wrong, but clearly someone behind the scenes is in favor of the East Coast. So, Mitch, would you like to present?
So what's the final score? Is it, are we
East Coast
2-1?
Yeah, well,
obviously East Coast.
Slightly dubious.
2-1.
Guys, if you guys can show my phone here. If you can show my phone here for one moment. There's five haha reacts and three heart reacts. That is West Coast.
Yes. That is West Coast.
That's West Coast.
I think
Sergio, you want to die alone on that?
I feel that you have someone behind the scenes that is maybe manipulating these numbers.
Yeah, that's a
I don't want to name any names. But
Billy, what are you doing?
We may have to look into a recap, but we'll address the voting's being rigged. So it's who
I mean
been tampered with, the whole thing's gone off. Ministry of Rum's blowing up right now. It's all gone to shit.
It is my life goal to make Ministry of Rum blow up. Oh my god.
Yeah.
That's well. We
and he's gonna win again. So we seem to have a problem. Can we get the technical difficulties sign up maybe now? I'm getting signed for some technical difficulties.
Well, apparently the East Coast winds isn't going away. So.
Sorry, Sergio.
No.
we will have an official recap in the following days. But for now, as it stands, the host is blaming poor explanations, so we will see. But anyway, but the point of today was kind of to pit some of the great rum lines from great rum bars from around the world together, and we thought it was fun to sort of have this little East Coast West Coast throwdown, but also to highlight, you know, because some of these debates get so fucking crazy online, and it's good to actually voice them out. It's good to talk them out, and it's good to hear the arguments for both sides and hear them laid out in a potentially more reasonable fashion,
or just with a little bit of humor, because I think a lot of debates are often better if you can inject some humor in, and maybe we can move things a bit more forward by doing that.
Yeah, these debates are always done better in person. With a daiquiri or a pina colada.
Or a pina colada.
At the bar. But guys, any final statements, any last comments, any last jibes you'd like to get in before we finish up our session?
Thank you so much for putting this together. It's the whole day has been absolutely exceptional. Honestly, from educational opportunities to pure entertainment, it's just been fantastic.
George. Thank you so much.
Except for someone counting. But
yeah, this has been awesome. I've been listening all day on and off as I've been in and out of work and things like that. And I just feel incredibly honored to be a part of this with all these incredible heavy hitters of rum and masterminds of rum, and I feel like I've just learned so much, and I just feel very special that you wanted to hear me talk about rum. So thank you.
No, thank you. No, thank you, Jen. It means so much to us that you guys are supporting us. You know, I think we never forget where we came from, and, you know, to have you guys on is an absolute honor. So thank you.
Yeah. No, it's amazing. I look forward to meeting you all in person.
Yeah. in about 9 hours.
Puerto Rico.
Yeah, I'll see you down there. We'll have a pina colada with Don Q.
Heck yeah, pina colada!
I think to play this song out, we should sing the pina colada song.
So, yeah. I should have definitely had that.
I tried. I was trying to find it on my Spotify, and it doesn't come up except for like 9,000 playlists of random beach tunes.
That's because it's called Escape.
Yeah.
Thanks, Sergio.
Ah. Escape. No one knows. That's like a game that we play at my bar. What is the name of the Pina Colada song? I'll give you
called
a bottle.
Escape.
No one knows the answer. It's Escape.
Yeah. Like
So when I type in this, when I type in Escape, Enrique Iglesias also comes up. So.
Probably a better one.
Here we go.
That's a terrible song.
Are we getting our butt out?
I'm glad the run made it. Yes, we should have a shot together before we finish up. Oh, get your tots out. Actually,
get your tots out.
Talking about getting your tots out, we saw your comments today. So Dawn and I have got our tots. Dawn's is apparently slightly bigger than mine. So hold on, I'll get a bigger one.
Wow.
Here we go. Oh, she's been me again. Hold on. We'll upgrade. Oh, she's been me again. Here we go. Cheers, everyone.
Been a great experience. It was fun.
Thank you so much for joining us. And we will see you at Trailer 30 for the after party if we survive the next few hours.
So good luck.
We'll see you all very soon. Oh, good. Well.
Wow.
I mean, I imagine we've offended most of the rum industry now, so we've only got a few hours left. Let's see what else there we can do. So, wonderful. Where are we now?
We are going to a little interlude with a little sugarcane and champagne, but I think we've got a cocktail video or a couple of cocktail videos coming up first.